Good morning, everyone. My talk will be about AIDA and digital security. Well, in other words, it's about not only about AIDA, but a little bit more. So to start, let's switch. I can do it myself. Yes, I am sorry. Yes. Okay, first about me. I will talk about myself, then we'll have a small overview about the current situation with digital security. And we will see how things were passed, let's say 20, 30 years ago. And then we will talk about AIDA. And what can we do to improve the current situation? And if you have time at the end, there will be some questions and answers. About myself, I started as a programmer more than 27 years ago. It was something interesting. The computers were quite rare at that time. They existed, but not like personal computers. Maybe they existed too, but in any case, I was studying mathematics in the Moscow University, and I saw a TV set with some letters on the screen, and I was amazed, how can it be that the TV shows letters, not pictures? And then I learned about the existence of computers. And after that, I was lost for mathematics, but it was a quite interesting thing because I started to work more and more with computers, and this became passion for all my life. So I am the author of AIDA Pro and the decompiler. Hopefully that you heard about them. It's they are quite powerful disassembler and decompiler. Currently, I am CEO of Hexrays, the company that publishes these tools. And as I told you already, I have a passion about programming and writing nice, beautiful code. I'm not really a reverse engineer, but I'm a software developer. In other words, you can blame not only me, but I am on the other side of the barricade. We software developers are the ones who create vulnerabilities because we write bad code. And we try to do better, best our job, but it's not always possible. But on the other hand, one more thing is that if you take 25, 30 years ago, our lives were not really depending on computers, but today computers become so important and therefore software that we write for them becomes very, very important. So by writing a good software, we are making our lives better. So good software makes our lives better. We store more and more personal data digitally, medical records, bank account information, communications, personal videos, photos, and so on and so on. So our data becomes more and more important, and many decisions are taken based on digital data. So it means that digital security becomes, well, you all know about it, so that's a very, very important thing. And what makes things worse is that our devices are connected to each other virtually permanently, which makes them powerful, but on the other hand, this makes them very vulnerable at the same time. While we depend on the software, on the other hand, the current situation is far from being perfect. most of our software has vulnerabilities due to many, many different reasons. First of all, the design flaws. The software is not designed with security in mind. This is something that that's how it should be done, but it's not always possible. Especially, let's say, 20 years ago, we were not really thinking about it. If your program runs nicely and performs what it's supposed to do, we were already happy, and that was good enough for us. Second reason is buggy implementations. We are human beings, and we we make mistakes. No testing or very poor testing. Even today, there are many implementations that are not tested properly, and because of that, we have vulnerabilities. The environment changed as well. The program that was working fine for 10 years may suddenly become vulnerable because of a changed configuration or different various ways of using it. So it's used differently, and because of that, it becomes vulnerable. As all of you know, we hear tons of stories about stolen credit cards, disclosed sensitive information. I think that nowadays, almost every day, we hear something new, a new story about vulnerability. And don't forget that many such stories go unnoticed. For example, even our company, Hexrays, we had our share of this kind of thing. May 2015, this year, we had one of our servers kind of hacked. Fortunately, no sensitive information was really leaked, so because we had a good division of computers, so they were separated from each other. But we have to know that sooner or later it can happen that your computers can get hacked, and because of that, you have to be prepared. So, on one hand, we can say, is everything lost? Well, while there will be more and more stories about hacked computers, I think that the situation is improving over time. Our software improves, the new systems get designed with security in mind, and our society knows how to handle digital security related issues in a better way. We have better laws and so on. But we are a very, very long way ahead of us to do. So what else improves? Compilers become better. I remember the very first compilers would not issue, for example, any warnings at all, and that was kind of difficult for us. We have more compilers. Compiling the same source with different compilers already gives us better results. Our programming languages evolve. C++, for example, had no templates. We have better languages than C++, and so on. We have better programming paradigms, better design patterns, better revision systems, and so on. So overall, situation is improving quite a lot. Also, we have better source analyzers. 25 years ago, for example, there was nothing, just lint, nothing else. We have testing frameworks, we have better debuggers, the word fuzzer, Valgrind, and other things to help with software development. In fact, today, writing software is much easier than in the past. Just by looking at the number of source code lines, we can tell that it was really difficult to write it in the past. For example, Windows, in 93 it had only 4 million lines of code, which is also quite a big number. But in 2003, it has had already over 50 million lines of code, which means that it was easy to write them. It was easier to write and test them. So, in other words, writing software is hard. First of all, it's hard because our tools are not perfect. And in the past, they were even worse. We have very slow computers. We had very slow computers. Today, it's different. The operating systems were not that great neither. There was no memory protection. Our methodologies were not that great, and so on and so on and so on. But let's go back in time and see how the situation was, let's say, 30 years ago or 25 years ago. Fortunately, I did not have to use this editor. There was an editor called ED, and it was a text editor, but it had no visual feedback. So, if you wanted to write some program, you had to do it line by line. As you see, you start at the editor, it shows the, how many lines we have, you move to the line number 5, you print one line at a time, and you can modify it, and write down, write it back to the file, for example. So this is how it was working. Fortunately, I had a better editor to start with. But anyway, this editor was considered as a powerful tool. It had regular expressions, it was programmable, and some Linux distributions, I think, that still include it, so it can be used. Can imagine how it was difficult to implement, to write programs using such an editor. Compilers were as well not that great. There were almost no warnings at all. The compiler could either issue an error message and stop, or sometimes it could even produce buggy code, which happens even today, but it happens quite rarely. I remember that 20 years ago, I write some code, it compiles, I have to look, it doesn't work correctly. I look for bugs in my source code, I cannot find anything. Then I check the compiler output, and I notice that something is wrong. The compiler made the generated wrong code. So I have to modify my code just to work around the compiler bug. Well, on the other hand, anyway, I was considering software compiler writers as semi-gods because they were doing some kind of magic on the source code, and they were changing it, transforming it into a binary code. I remember that there were Turbo C compilers from Borland. They were much, much better from what we had initially. And they were kind of a breath of fresh air. They were fast, and they were much they were much user friendlier than before. I'm sorry. So did I? I'm not doing anything. No. Funny, it changes by itself. Anyway, you are doing, I'm sorry. There were not many debuggers. I remember that the Turbo Debugger was one of the best debuggers. It was powerful, robust, it could even display the source code, and it supported hardware breakpoints, and the conditional breakpoints were also available. That was something amazing for that time. So, but I remember that in some period of my time, despite of the availability of Turbo Debugger, I could not really use it because my software was bigger, occupying all memory, and I had to debug using anything else but not the real debugger. Then there was SoftWise, which was a system-level debugger. It could debug the entire operating system. It was very powerful. It was so popular that its popularity was even a disadvantage in some cases, because there were some anti-SoftWise tricks that were employed by software. So there were some anti-SoftWise tricks. This is how it works. They were checking the presence of SoftWise, and if the SoftWise was present, they were doing something else, for example. Debuggers were good, but they were not enough in some cases. First of all, programs get bigger, and our memory was limited, and therefore we could not fit everything into memory. Some algorithms were just too complex to understand in a debugger. Anti-debugger tricks were used more often, and in some cases, just more detailed analysis was required, especially for viruses. And disassemblers were the answer to these questions. They would allow us to analyze the program in depth. They could show cross references, and allow us to assign meaningful names to functions and data. The most popular disassembler at that time was the disassembler called Sourcer from V Communications. It was working like magic. It could tell apart code from data. This is a task that has no solution in general. It could assign meaningful names and comments to the code, which was looking like magic. The biggest shortcoming of Sourcer was that it was a batch mode program. A typical work was to launch it and wait quite long time. It could take even hours to disassemble a big program. That was the biggest problem, and therefore we needed something else. The interactivity was the answer, so we needed something interactive. There was at that time a disassembler called DisDoc. I haven't used it myself, so I cannot tell you much about it, but the idea was great. There was no need to wait for the results, and the user could browse the assembly listing immediately after loading the file into the disassembler. And it had something called WYSIWYG, what you see is what you get principle. You remember ED I showed you, that was a big difference between interactive work and seeing everything in front of your eyes. The listing was displayed very nicely. So that was the principal reason why I decided to create IDA. Initially, I tried a few approaches, but none of them were really satisfactory. They were either too slow, either too limited. It took me maybe 4 or even more times to rewrite the code from scratch because it was not working correctly. It was not working enough. And remember that time our processors were slow and memory was limited. And the biggest obstacle I had was a database. I needed a good database. It should be fast, it should be robust, and there was nothing. I could not find anything good. I tried some available databases like Paradox from Borland. They were just too slow for my needs, so I decided I had to find something else. Fortunately, my friend Pavel Rusnak implemented a B3 engine. If you know about, a little about databases, B3 engines are used for indexing data in databases. So they are a very fast thing. Usually databases use database engines use B3s only for the indexing purposes, but we decided to store information in B3s, unlike other database engines, which made our database quite fast, faster than anything else. But on the other hand, we were vulnerable to any power outages or any problems because we had no transactions. And even today, it's this way. We are still using this database. And we improved it, of course, a lot. But we are still using the same code as 20 years ago. So the first public version of IDA, it was released in May 1991. It took me around 6 months to implement it. So there was the basic functionality. The user could browse the listing. It supported only x86 instructions, but it was interactive and it was working. So I was quite happy with it, and I made the first public version free for everyone. And after that, there was a lot of improvements. I started to work on this project. I wouldn't say more and more. It was just fun project for me. It was not. It didn't have any commercial interest. Just something I like to do because I like to learn how to program. I wanted to learn how other programs work, and nice December was something like I needed for that. It was a tool I needed myself. So during all these years, starting from 91, I was releasing new versions more and more, quite often. The version 2.09 was interesting because it was using TurboVision library from Borland, and it changed the user interface. It became much nicer. At that time, IDA was supporting 3 processor families, 8 different input file types, and already had a small built-in C-like language. So IDA was growing slowly. I was working on it in all my free time. So there were new versions. I just showing you a few slides showing some of the selected versions. Over time, you see that I continued to improve it. I added OS2, MS-DOS extender version. IDA had loadable modules and so on. So anyway, I will not stop and all these versions just to go faster and not to bore you. Initially, I had really ambitious plans for IDA. I wanted to have a kind of artificial intelligence with a Lisp-like language. I wanted to implement a binary program optimizer on top of IDA. One more idea was to use IDA for binary translation. You see that there are many ideas, like I had the idea of creating kind of a knowledge database. It is okay. It's okay to have more ideas that you can implement. And even today, we have the same situation, more ideas that we can implement. And as soon as we had more and more new users of IDA, they were asking for new features themselves. So this way, our to-do list is growing and growing and growing without any hope to make it smaller. That's okay. It's a normal situation. I was lucky to meet Mr. Pierre van de Ven in 1996. Because DataRescue converted my fan project into a commercial program in at that time. And it was Pierre's idea that we must implement a graphical user interface because otherwise it's not good enough. And we worked together quite a long time. And by the way, Pierre found the lady we use for IDA logo. Many people think that it's this lady is Ada, the woman that programmed the first programmer, but it is not the case. This lady has nothing to do with programming at all. This is Madame de Maintenon. She is a lover of a French king. Then we continued to improve IDA together with Pierre, and our efforts were noticed by many, many people, and our user base was started to grow quite substantially. And even in 2001, we were invited to Las Vegas as a finalist of PC Magazine Technical Excellence Award. We went to Las Vegas and we lost the competition. Well, that's okay, it happens. It was still fun, it was still interesting. Unfortunately, at that time, we were really plagued with piracy. In fact, we had more pirates than legitimate users. Maybe it's because of the nature of IDA. IDA is used by many hackers. It can be used for good and bad, but the problem we had with pirates were very simple. They were eating our time and resources. They were social engineering, and they were doing it so in a so predictable way, it was not even interesting, it was boring for us. An unknown guy would appear, would send us a message saying, oh, hi, I saw your program, it's a great program, by the way, very nice. Our answer is thank you, and the second message says, oh, by the way, could you help me? I have a little problem with it, I cannot use it. And, so, if you are not paying customer and asking for help, I don't know, either you pirate and then don't show up, or either pay and get support. But some of the pirates were really insisting that they are entitled for support even without paying. That was quite odd for me. I still don't understand this person, these people. This is just a map showing how many pirates we had, let's say, this map is made in 2006, but even before that, the situation was not better. Today, it became better, and we still have pirates, but at least they understand, most of them, let's say, that they are not entitled for support. Maybe we receive one or two messages a week asking for questions from non-registered users. But back in 2001, we had more requests from pirates than anyone else. And we were receiving, let's say, 5-10 messages, and all of them from pirates. It was quite discouraging. Well, anyway, we were doing this stuff, working on IDA, not because it was fun for us and it was interesting. So it was just pirates were considered as a kind of nuisance for us, nothing else. Second, well, the biggest idea I had is, well, the obvious thing to do after the assembler. Let me click. That's it. Thank you. Was to write a decompiler on top of IDLE. This is an idea that was in the air, and I read a PhD thesis of Christian Cifuentes. This was a very good work. It was explaining how to implement a decompiler from scratch. After reading it, it was clear in my mind how to build a robust, nice decompiler. But the devil is in details. So even when you start to implement something like that, you encounter so many minor problems that can grow into something big. So I had to come up with an idea, test it, implement and test it, and sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't work. If it doesn't work, okay, then throw away and start over. So in a sense, it's wash, rinse, and repeat, and for years. I think that it took me maybe almost 10 years to implement a nice decompiler. And but I was doing it because I was liking it. It's a nice thing, it's interesting, so you are getting something, you know, a lot of fun, and you see that sooner or later you will reach the goal. That's why it was interesting. Decompilation is a complex problem. It's unsolvable in general, and it's very time consuming, and so many decisions to take, so many code to write. So one has to cut some corners. Without cutting corners, it's impossible to come up with a working decompiler. And the question was which corners to cut. So even today, if you take out decompiler, you will see that sooner or later you can hit some limitation. Well, that's okay. We have to live with this kind of limitations because we don't have anything better yet. Unfortunately, in 2007, Pierre decided to stop. There were many reasons for that. Pirates were one of the reasons. There were other reasons as well. But anyway, I respect his decision, and we separated in good terms. I wanted him to continue, in fact, and to do something together with the decompiler, but Pierre did not want to do so. So I had to continue the journey alone, and I founded my own company called Hexrays, and then it became kind of a different story because we built a nice and passionate team in Hexrays. We have developers who care about the code. We want to publish as bug-free software as we can, and we do care about our users. I think that more than 50% of our time is spent just working on some support requests from our users. If they ask for a new feature or some bug fixes, we try to give them the fixed version as soon as possible, within days or even within some hours. So that was a long story. It took me almost 25 years to work on IDLE. So you can ask, why did you spend all your life on this thing? I started IDLE because there was nothing interactive at that time. And after a few years, I noticed that there's a need in such a tool. Our society needs a nice tool to analyze any kinds of programs, be it malware, be it viruses. So I kept maintaining IDLE all these years because IDLE is a useful tool. And I noticed one good thing is that I like our IDLE users. They are in general, very nice people. I love to interact with them. I like to talk to them. They are clever. They have good ideas, and they are very nice and polite, especially the legitimate ones. On the other hand, either can be used for lowly deeds, for a bad to some, for example, to crack software, to steal code, algorithms, and so on. Well, any other tool can be used this way, so the user is responsible in this case. For myself, I consider IDA as a microscope. It looks like a microscope. It can be used for good and bad. It requires some skills to use it efficiently, and it's basically useless for the general public, but it's an indispensable tool for professionals. Quite often I am asked who use IDA, what kind of users we have. There are so many different categories. I would say that they are just a motley crew of all kinds of people. You can find antivirus companies. This is one of the biggest users. Quite many security organizations, governments, military, single hobbyists, and shady persons of all kinds. Well, and pirates as well, of course. Some of them even funny. For example, we had a priest that was asking for a free copy of IDA, and he was promising that he would pray for us. Or there was a student that wanted a free copy, and he wanted it urgently because his customer cannot wait. He had an urgent task to do with it. I consider that IDA improves digital security. Our legitimate users are white hats. Well, at least I prefer to believe that they are white hats. At least on our side, when someone comes and wants to buy IDA, we always try to do some background checks and refuse a sale if we don't if we think that the user is not really who he's pretending to be. IDA itself is not in the spotlight and stays in shadow, but many of our users are famous security researchers, so we can say that we are helping them with their tasks, and I'm glad that we can do so. And we want IDA to be efficient, robust, and safe for them, so you can use it safely. So to make IDA safe, we have to improve the quality of the product, IDA itself. So what do we do for that? We run tests. We compile our code with various compilers on different platforms. We use code reviews. We use tons of various verification tools, be it Lint, Valgrind, and others. And when a user complains about a bug in our software, we at Hexrays, we handle things ourselves. I mean, the developers handle user reports. We don't have first or second helplines, and this kind of ensures that developers suffer from their bugs, which is a good thing in my opinion. This way they have an incentive to create less bugs and write better code. We continuously work on improving our coding style. We add more test cases. In fact, every reported bug creates a new test case. We write test cases quite often now. And we keep adding more testing methods as well. We have a quite extensive test suite for our analysis engine. We run all our tests on three different platforms. It's Windows, Linux, and Mac OS X. We recently added a testing engine for the user interface. And we have quite a fast-growing set of decompiler tests. I think that currently the test suite is a few terabytes, only counting the output files. And I hope that we will improve it. We will add more and more tests in the future. So we can say that virtually every day we add a new test case. And we have some dedicated computers that run tests. And by the way, we have also a bug bounty program for critical bugs. And despite all of these things, we know that we are still not testing either enough, and we plan to add more testing methods. Just a few words about the bug bounty program. The idea is very simple. If you find a critical bug in IDA, we will pay you a bounty. I think that the currently bounty is around $3,000, US dollars. It's not only us who do that. I think that you are very familiar with the concept. I think that it's a really good idea, and all software development companies should be doing, should be offering bug bounties. In fact, it's a very cheap way of getting informed about the bugs. Because the bugs reported using the bug bounty, they are critical, they are important, and they are very difficult to find. A researcher spent his time and resources to find the bug and to write a nice report. Why not reward him by paying him bug bounty? I think that it's a very fair and good idea. On the other hand, we try to make IDA more difficult to exploit IDA. What do we do for that? We personalize the kernel for each user. It has two purposes. First of all, it makes difficult to write reliable exploits. And second, since we personalize each copy, we know where each copy ends up. So we don't want IDA copies to end up available publicly on the internet. We use ASLR. We also randomize the heap at the start. We use stack canaries. Our stack is not executable, so we try to use all these best practices available today to improve IDA. By the way, we offer bug bounties even if there is no proof of concept code for if it's a memory corruption bug. And we plan to improve things in the near future by adding fuzzer. In fact, we already have a fuzzer in our test methods. We do fuzz IDA ourselves, which is also a good idea. And I think that I wouldn't say that all software companies, but many most software companies should be using fuzzers themselves as well. So they should their software development tools should not be limited to compilers and debuggers. They should include also fuzzers as well. So I consider fuzzer as a software development tool, not only for attacking. It can be used to detect vulnerabilities in this code. We plan to add a good static code analyzer. We already have a couple, but it doesn't hurt to add one more. We want to write more tests for the debuggers. And more tests for IDA Python, so more testing and more testing, more testing. I know that there are no bug-free programs, they do not exist, but still, every bug we find in IDA, we consider it as kind of a painful thing for us. It's a kind of reminder that our program is not good, we have to improve it and work on it even more. So, why does it happen so that we try to write good programs, but it still doesn't work? We still have bugs in the program, in our programs. I could give this comparison. it's kind of, we are kind of blind people. We don't see our bugs with our eyes. Our eyes are useless for seeing bugs. An analogy could be, imagine that a blind person needs to make a watertight liquid recipient. He cannot do it, he cannot see any holes using his eyes, so he has to palpate it entirely to ensure that there are no holes. We are doing more or less the same thing with software. We are essentially blind to security holes, and we see only the most obvious ones, which means that as humans, we cannot ensure security. And therefore, we need some help. We need to make our tools, we need something that will help us with this task of finding our vulnerabilities. And in my opinion, computers can help us with the task. As humans, we cannot do it, we cannot find all vulnerabilities, but computers can scan, test our software, monitor, prove its correctness, and serve as a seeing aid. And maybe in the future, I don't know, not today, but at least in the future, maybe computers would develop software for us as well. That would be great because they would make less mistakes. We cannot test all cases, but it's not an excuse to abandon testing altogether. So we have to test continuously. We have to continue to improve, to test as many different aspects as possible. And thinking as an attacker could help because this way we would see the possible scenarios. Keep adding tests. And it's also a good idea to write a test case before fixing the bug. So more and more testing, it doesn't hurt to test more. Testing is not enough. We also need to monitor our systems continuously. And again, humans cannot do it themselves, so we must use some kind of testing monitoring software I don't know, there are many commercial solutions exist, there are also open source solutions. I would tend to use some open source solution like OSSEC or similar. Writing custom scripts has the advantage of being unknown to the attackers, which is a good thing. We could ask computers to prove that our software is correct. For that, we could use software verification tools. Unfortunately, C++ is not the best language for verification. So maybe it's a good idea to switch to other languages. Modern languages provide better support for verification. We can also use code generation tools. I think that this is a part of the software development that improves quite a lot recently, and maybe in the future these tools will become mainstream. And I think that's all. It was, I don't know, fast or slow. I would like to thank you for your attention, and if you have any questions. No.